this is the captain speaking. As you no doubt may be aware, we have a small problem with our engines.
This is what it sounds like when a pilot tells a white lie. The small problem that Malcolm Waters, the captain of Cathay Pacific Flight 780, is referring to is that one of the plane's engines has stopped, and the other one is stuck on high power and will not slow down. The 309 passengers on board this plane don't realize it, but there is a very good chance that in a few minutes they will end up crashing into the South China Sea. The only thing standing between them and that outcome is the skill and teamwork of the two Australian pilots in the cockpit. With every passing minute, the condition of their aircraft worsens. Can they make it to Hong Kong before their engines deteriorate entirely? This is a situation which the pilots were never trained for, and for which no standard procedure exists. This is the story of Cathay Pacific Flight 780. On the morning of April 13th, 2010, Cathay Pacific Flight 780 prepared to push back from its gate at Juranda International Airport in Surabaya, Indonesia, for its 5-hour journey to Hong Kong. On board were 309 passengers and 13 crew. The aircraft being used for this flight was an 11-year-old Airbus A330, one of over 30 such aircraft in Cathay's fleet at the time. The A330 is a popular medium to long-haul aircraft, with over 1,000 in service worldwide in the year 2010. In the cockpit on this flight were two pilots. They had flown this aircraft into Surabaya the previous night, and had stayed overnight in a nearby hotel. The captain, Malcolm Waters, was 35 years old, and had been working for Cathay Pacific for the last 12 years. He had over 7,000 hours of flying experience, 2,500 of which were on the A330. The first officer, David Hayhoe, was 37 years old, and had just over 4,000 hours of flying experience, 1,000 of which were on the A330. Much of his previous flying experience was with the Australian Air Force, where he had served for 11 years. The aircraft still had 9,000 kilograms of fuel on board when it landed in Surabaya the previous night. The captain ordered the uptaking of a further 24,000 kilograms of fuel for the 3,500 kilometer journey to Hong Kong. The weather on this day was perfect for flying. The forecast was for clear skies en route, and as the pilots taxied their aircraft to the runway, there was no indication that this would be anything other than a routine flight. The passengers and crew had no idea that they were in grave danger. Over the next few hours, the pilots would have to deal with a series of escalating warnings from their onboard computers. These would appear benign at first, but would culminate in a nightmare scenario that they had never been trained for. Flight 780 lifted off from runway 28 at Surabaya at 24 minutes past 8 local time. The first officer was flying the aircraft back to Hong Kong, and the captain was handling radio communications. The first sign that something was amiss came during the climb, when the pilots noticed that the engine instruments showed abnormal EPR fluctuations for the number 2 engine, the one on the right-hand side of the aircraft. EPR stands for engine pressure ratio, which is a measure of the difference in pressure between the front of the engine and the back. The EPR is used as an indication of the thrust output of the engines, and the pilot's instruments were showing that the engine was having some trouble maintaining the desired thrust output. The number 1 engine on the left-hand side of the aircraft was also giving unusual readings, but these were within a narrower range than the fluctuations in engine 2. The first indication that this abnormality might be serious came just before 9 a.m, when the aircraft was level at 39,000 feet. A warning came up on the ECAM, or Electronic Centralized Aircraft Monitoring System, saying, "Engine 2 control system fault." This system also displayed the message, "Engine 2 slow response," meaning that engine 2 would now be slow to respond to movements of the thrust lever. Captain Waters wanted to clarify the significance of these warnings, so he contacted Cathay Pacific's Operations Center for technical advice. The maintenance engineer on the other end of the line asked the pilots to move the thrust levers and see how the engines responded. They did this and noted that the EPR was still fluctuating. However, because the other engine parameters were normal, the crew decided to continue the flight to Hong Kong. About an hour later, the engine 2 control system fault warning reappeared on the ECAM, along with the warning advising the pilots to avoid rapid thrust changes. The pilots turned on the engine anti-ice system to see if this would fix the abnormal EPR readings, but this had no effect. They contacted maintenance control again and informed them that the EPR fluctuations had now become larger. They asked whether it was safe to continue the flight to Hong Kong. The maintenance control engineer on the other end of the line hypothesized that the EPR instability on engine number 1 may be a result of the flight computer trying to compensate for the instability on engine number 2. In other words, it may in fact just be engine number 2 that had a problem. He advised the flight crew to continue monitoring the engine parameters and told them that the fuel metering unit, which controls the amount of fuel being fed to the engines, would be replaced when they arrived at Hong Kong. The flight continued more or less as normal for the next 2 hours. As far as the pilots were concerned, the engine readings were unusual, but nothing to be concerned about. In their minds, they would soon be landing in Hong Kong as normal, and it would be maintenance's job to deal with the engine trouble once they had parked at the gate. At 20 past 1 in the afternoon, Hong Kong time, the plane was about 110 nautical miles from the airport on its initial descent. From this moment onwards, the crew's situation would get progressively worse. As the plane was descending through 30,000 feet, the captain reported hearing a light pop sound, which was followed by the smell of ozone and a burning smell in the cockpit. This was quickly followed by two new ECAM messages, Engine 1 control system fault and, critically, Engine 2 stall. The second warning about an engine stall was particularly troublesome. The flight crew followed standard procedure for an engine stall and reduced the power on Engine 2 to flight idle, the lowest setting that keeps the engine running. The ECAM then displayed new warnings for Engine 1, which read, Engine 1 slow response, and avoid rapid thrust changes. These were the same warnings they had received for Engine 2 previously. To compensate for the reduced thrust from Engine 2, the crew pushed the Engine 1 thrust lever to the setting known in Airbus aircraft as MCT, or Maximum Continuous Thrust. This is the highest thrust setting that an engine can stay at for a prolonged period of time. However, despite this, Engine 1 never reached this thrust output. Instead, it increased slightly from where it was, and then decreased back to about 37%. Still over 100 miles from their destination, the flight crew were now faced with a serious problem. One of their engines was stalling and had to be run at the lowest setting, while the other one was running way too slow. Without sufficient engine power, they would lose speed and be unable to maintain altitude. They were now on a slow-motion collision course with the South China Sea. The captain called Hong Kong Air Traffic Control and declared a pan-pan, which is one step down from declaring an emergency. The pilots had previously carried out an approach briefing for a normal arrival at Hong Kong, but they now had to quickly change plan. They briefed for what's known as a one-engine inoperative approach, and also briefed the missed approach procedures in case their first approach was unsuccessful. Eager to get on the ground before their situation deteriorated further, they requested a shortened path to the runway from air traffic control, which was granted. Captain Waters went on the PA system and told the flight attendants to prepare for landing. He also briefed the chief cabin crew member, known as the in-flight service manager, about the engine problems. He then took over from the first officer as the pilot flying, given the fact that they were operating on one engine now. As the plane continued its descent, the crew received permission from air traffic control to maintain high speed so that they could make it to the airport as soon as possible. Having gone through all the relevant checklists, the captain recapped the situation to the first officer and asked if there was anything else they might not be thinking about. The pilots agreed that they had covered all the necessary details, however, and that their task now lay in landing the crippled aircraft. It was now looking as if the situation had stabilized. The plane was about 50 nautical miles from the runway, and the pilots had briefed for a single-engine approach. At 1:30 in the afternoon, however, things took another serious turn for the worse. The pilots received a warning that Engine 1 had now stalled. Their situation was now critical, and the first officer made a Mayday call to air traffic control, saying,
Approach, Mayday, 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 Cathay 780 had Engine 1 and Engine 2 stall. Currently, we require a lower descent, maintaining 8,000.
The crew was cleared to descend to 3,000 feet, and they began working through their checklist to deal with the stalled engine. Just as they had done with the other engine minutes earlier, they moved the thrust lever for Engine 1 to the idle position. The aircraft was now essentially a giant glider. If the pilots were going to have any chance of landing in Hong Kong, they had to get at least one of their engines working. They were still in the clouds at this point, and their speed was steadily decreasing. The captain had disconnected the autopilot and was now flying manually, trying to keep the aircraft at its green dot speed of 202 knots. Green dot speed is an Airbus term for the speed which ensures the furthest glide distance when the engines have failed. For this reason, as you may have noticed, it's the inspiration for the name of this YouTube channel. The captain tested the controllability of the engines by moving the thrust levers one at a time. If he could get even one engine working, the plane would make it to Hong Kong. Fearing a loss of electrical power if the engines got any worse, the pilots turned on the auxiliary power unit. Finally, the aircraft broke out of the clouds, and the pilots were able to get a better picture of where they were. Air traffic control then advised the pilots as to how to get to the airport quickly.
Cathay 780, roger. On your present heading, they will bring you a close base around Lantau Island. I'll advise if this is any, if you're too close. Cathay 780, roger. I can't see Lantau for cloud, but we've got this island just to the southeast of the airfield. 780, roger. Your present heading is the most efficient to miss the Lantau Island and still make the right base. Cathay 780, roger.
Having tested each of the thrust levers, Captain Waters discovered that Engine 1 still responded somewhat, so he decided to use this engine to keep the aircraft flying. He also set the engine start switch to ignition to reduce the chances that the engine would flame out when it was needed most. As the plane neared the airport, it was traveling too fast for this part of the approach, so the captain started pulling back the thrust lever for the number one engine. However, the engine wasn't responding. Waters continued bringing the thrust lever back until it was in the idle position, but the engine itself stayed at a high setting of 74%. This was a serious problem. Now one engine was stuck on a high thrust setting, while the other was basically dead. This crew would now have to attempt a landing faster than anything their aircraft was designed for, and faster than they had ever trained for. The danger was no longer that they would crash short of the runway into the sea, but that they would overrun the runway and end up in the sea anyway. The first officer told the flight attendants to prepare for a possible evacuation. The captain then made a PA to the passengers, telling them that there was, quote, a small problem with the engines, and urged them to fasten their seatbelts. To help slow the aircraft down, the crew extended the speed brakes, which are flaps that pop up from the top of the wings and disrupt the airflow. In order to put more distance between himself and the runway, and to give himself more time to slow down, the captain started to zigzag the aircraft. The plane was not slowing down, however. The overspeed warning began to sound as the aircraft reached 244 knots, indicating that the aircraft was at risk of structural damage due to how fast it was going. Air traffic control then cleared the aircraft to land. At a distance of 3 miles from the runway, and at 1,000 feet above the water, the aircraft was still travelling at 230 knots, which is almost twice the normal final approach speed. As they descended through 900 feet, the crew stowed the speed brakes. Even though these were preventing the speed from increasing further, they were too dangerous to leave extended any longer, as doing so would lead to the plane hitting the runway too hard on landing. The first officer asked whether they should set the flaps to 2, and the captain agreed this would be worth a try, as it might slow the aircraft down somewhat, even though it risked damaging the flaps. At this moment, the terrain alarm sounded, as the aircraft was descending rapidly towards the ground while not in a normal landing configuration. The overspeed warning sounded again, as the aircraft was travelling too fast for the flap setting that had been selected. The captain's full attention was on making sure that the plane didn't impact too hard, so that he could maintain control of it as it careened down the runway. At 15 minutes to 2 in the afternoon, the aircraft slammed down onto the runway at a speed of 231 knots, or 426 kilometers per hour, almost twice the normal landing speed. It bounced, and then hit the ground again, this time scraping the left engine against the runway. The spoilers deployed automatically, and the captain deployed the thrust reversers, but only the number one engine thrust reverser deployed successfully. He stepped on the brakes, which reached temperatures above 1000 degrees Celsius, and began to glow. The aircraft continued to skid along the runway, and was rapidly running out of space. Finally, after a 2.5 kilometer fight to stop the aircraft, the pilots finally brought it to rest, just 309 meters from the end of the runway. Everyone on board had survived the ordeal, but now there was a new problem. After shutting down the engines, the pilots looked at the brake temperatures. They had reached the top of the scale on their instruments, which was 995 degrees Celsius. The fire crew, which had arrived at the aircraft, reported that they could see smoke and a fire on the landing gear, and the captain quickly gave the order to evacuate. In the end, 56 passengers received minor injuries in the evacuation, and one passenger fractured and dislocated their left ankle and required hospitalization for surgery. The high-speed landing itself did not result in any injuries. All 309 passengers and 13 crew survived the ordeal. It's hard to overstate what an incredible achievement this landing was. During their approach to Hong Kong, the crew stayed calm and continued to collaborate in a highly effective manner, despite being faced with a totally novel set of failures for which they had never been trained. They made sound decisions for the entirety of this ordeal, and safely landed a plane which could very easily have ended up in the ocean. In recognition of their achievement, Captain Waters and First Officer Hayhoe were each given the Polaris Award by the International Federation of Airline Pilots Associations, which is the highest decoration associated with civil aviation. As positively as this story turned out, however, the question remained as to what had caused all this in the first place. How could a modern aircraft like the A330 suffer such a catastrophic failure? The suspicion of investigators quickly fell on the fuel. When they closely examined the engines and fuel tanks, they made a shocking discovery. Many engine components were clogged with thousands of tiny spheres, made of superabsorbent polymer material, or SAP. After examining the chemical composition of these spheres, investigators determined that they could only have one source, the fuel pump itself, back at Surabaya. Specifically, they found that they must have come from a part of the fuel pump known as the filter monitor. The filter monitor acts, as the name suggests, like a filter, ensuring that trace amounts of water and other particles in the fuel being pumped from the below-ground tanks do not make it to the aircraft's fuel tanks. The filter monitor is almost like a series of coffee filters stacked on top of one another, with each layer filtering out a different kind of material. Part of this filter consists of a superabsorbent polymer layer, whose function is to absorb any water from the fuel being passed through it. In absorbing this water, however, this material swells and turns into a kind of gel. Here's a picture from the final report of what it looks like when this material swells to form a gel. In normal circumstances, if there is enough water in the fuel, this material swells enough that it actually blocks the filter and cuts off the water-contaminated fuel supply to the aircraft. So, why didn't this happen with Cathay Flight 780? How did this material end up in the fuel tanks of the aircraft? On closer examination, investigators discovered that this material was not just exposed to normal waterlogged fuel. The water in the fuel was, in fact, salt water. Salt water is known to reduce the filter's natural ability to shut off when it's overloaded with water. Investigators concluded that as the aircraft was being fueled, the SAP material in the filter swelled and congealed due to the presence of large amounts of water, and that as fueling continued, the high pressure of the pump pushed the SAP gel through the filter and into the fuel, where it formed tiny spheres. As the engines ran throughout the flight, these spheres clogged up the fuel metering units, which controlled the amount of fuel entering the engines. This caused them to get stuck on a particular thrust setting. Ironically, this SAP material, the very thing that was meant to remove contaminants from the fuel, ended up being a contaminant. The person who carried out the aircraft fueling did not investigate when on numerous occasions during the fueling there was significant vibration in the hose, as well as an increase in differential pressure in the fueling system. This should have alerted him to the fact that something was amiss, but he ignored these telltale signs and simply stopped and restarted the fueling each time this occurred, each time pumping more and more salt water and SAP-laced fuel into the aircraft's tanks. As for where the salt water came from, investigators found that the refuel facility at Surabaya had recently been overhauled and several underground fuel pipes had been replaced during heavy rain. As the large steel pipes were cut, measured, and then resealed, water from an overflowing pond nearby made its way into the fuel lines. The final report made a number of recommendations aimed at improving the aircraft fueling procedures at Juranda Airport, as well as improving the oversight of fuel quality monitoring. Airbus also inserted a new section in the A330 pilot's quick reference handbook, titled Suspected Engine Fuel System Contamination, which helps pilots diagnose and deal with contaminated fuel. In the end, it's incredible that the lessons learned from this accident were learned without the loss of a single life. Special thanks to the Patreon and YouTube members for helping to make this video possible. If you'd like to help grow green.aviation, you can do so by tapping on the links here on screen, and I'd be very grateful for your support. I'd especially like to thank Andriy Shishkalov and Antilo Punny for their very generous contributions. I hope you enjoyed this video, thanks again for watching, and I'll see you next week for another episode.